Excited for all of you guys who are in the challenge. So our goal for this challenge is that we want you guys to see results by loving yourself more. Oftentimes, I think that we do it the opposite way, and I think that we're going to see more lasting effects when we go about it by taking care of our body, taking care of our mind. And so when you guys who have signed up and paid for your books, this is the book. Lisa did this beautiful book. It is amazing, and it has some really good recipes in here, so you guys are going to love it. And then you guys are also going to get a sheet about the things that I'm talking about tonight, too, so you'll know exactly what to do and can refer to this. So with the challenge, you're going to get the recipe book. You're going to get a meal template in there. We're going to have mini challenges based off of stuff you're going to learn tonight, and then tips along the way. So what do you want to do before the challenge? So you're going to want to look through the recipe book, plan with your meal plans, make sure that you're ready with food and everything that you need, and then you're going to want to make sure to take pictures. So pictures are going to be taken at your house holding a picture that says Core Love Yourself Challenge, hashtag that, and then the date March 9th. And then you're going to submit that to the email that's on here. It's coreloveyourselfchallenge@gmail.com. So email that to us there. And then, oh, I lost my thing. Let's see. Yeah, and then the first day on March 9th, so that's when you're going to take your picture, is actually on that date, sorry. And then during the challenge, you're going to watch for emails from that email, and we're going to be reminding you what the mini challenges are and tips and tricks along the way. And then the last day, you're gonna do the same thing, take a picture at the end, submit it to that email, and then we're gonna pick a winner. So it's gonna be awesome. You're gonna follow, you're gonna calculate your calories and your macros. This is what you're gonna follow. This is what's gonna help you see results along the way, and using those recipes in the recipe book and your own. So whatever works best for you. So that is the challenge. So. Turn the time back over to you.
Awesome. Thanks, Natalie. All right, so I wanted to introduce Heidi. When I asked her to give me some information about her life, she was very hesitant because she doesn't like to talk about herself. But I told her, like, you know, when I've gone and sat down and listened to a speaker, I feel like you take the first handful of minutes kind of sitting back, maybe with some walls up saying, okay, I need you to prove to me how smart you are before I really start to absorb what you're going to say. So I don't want that to happen. I want you guys from the very beginning, just have your walls down. Be open to exactly what she's going to teach you, because I'm going to read you a little bit about her, but then after that I'm going to tell you how she's affected me personally, my family personally, and she's a phenomenal person with so much deep knowledge, and you truly can leave here tonight completely changed if you take what she teaches you. So I just wanted to give you guys that so that you kind of pull those walls down and just be open and listen. So Heidi is the wife to Scott and the mother to 6 extraordinary kids. They range in age from 8 months to 18 years. When her oldest daughter was 12, she was diagnosed with anxiety and depression. In an effort to help her daughter in any way possible, she discovered foot zoning. It was a culminating moment for their family, as the foot zone was able to tie in a lot of loose ends and help her understand healing in a really empowering way. Determined to learn the zone to help her daughter, she also set an intention to help anyone who had gone through the same struggles they had. Upon graduating from foot zoning school, she was asked to teach for the school and spent the next year in an internship certifying as an instructor. Throughout her life, she has sought out learning about the mind and body connection. Foot zoning has helped her empower others about the power that lies within each one of us to tap into the body's ability to heal and feel the joy of being in a state of rest and repair. So, I first met Heidi, she was a client of mine. Years ago, she was a client of mine. At that time in my life, I was going through some incredibly challenging times, just emotionally going through a lot. She knew about those challenges, knew what was going on, and so she actually talked to me about foot zoning. And I was like, what? And so, I had my walls up. I wasn't totally open to it, but I was open to finding anything that would help me. So she referred me to the same foot zoner that her daughter went to, completely changed my life. Like, I could not believe it. It was the woo-woo stuff, like I like to call it. But it completely changed my life and really helped me bring together my mind, my body, my spirit, and just really becoming the best person that I could. And then after that, she started foot zoning. I started going to her, and I really have been able to tap into her as far as learning how food affects the body. Anytime we carry supplements here, she's a person I go to and say, what do you think of this? And she scrutinizes it and tears it apart, but it's what I need because she really understands what food does to your body and what it does to your emotions. I mean, she helped me massively on a personal level. And then at the time, my now wife was my girlfriend at the time. She has a daughter that was really struggling also emotionally, having going back and forth between houses because of a divorce and things like that. She was really struggling. And so I talked to my wife about Heidi. I was like, would you please just take her to get her feed zone? And that has completely changed her life. My wife has a picture of Maggie sitting with Heidi at the beginning of the zone. I mean, you can just see the emotional distress on her. And then after the zone, just a complete light girl. I mean, she was 5, 6 years old at the time. Completely changed her, and she is now all into, we meditate every night. She has her essential oils that she uses. She truly believes in this because it's changed her life, and she can tell when she's getting off. She's like, I need a foot zone with Heidi. She gets literally more excited over foot zones with Heidi than she does pedicures or even princess dresses. And that says a lot if you know this little girl. So anyways, I kind of focused there on the foot zoning, but I just want you to understand how well she understands the mind-body connection. And she's gonna talk to us a lot about food and how food affects the mind-body connection. So anyways, she's helped me, she's helped our clients, she's helped my family on a personal level. So without further ado, Heidi McKay.
Dedicated to the miracle of Western medicine. We love it. It's a miracle. I never wanted to go back. It didn't feel good, and she just kind of like went through this little thing and said, oh my gosh, you're right, you're a mess. And I was like, that was the worst experience of my life. Like, that was terrible. And so she really had to keep like talking me into it, and she finally said, what do you have to lose? You've used every other resource that you know. And I said, you're right, I'm at the end of my rope. And she's a very convincing friend, and not forceful, but convincing. And so I just thought, she's right, I'm gonna go try this. So the first time my daughter was zoned, I can't tell you one thing that that zoner told us. But I do know that after 3 years of wondering if my daughter was safe with her thoughts going to bed every night, for 10 days I had my daughter back. 10 days, that light that was gone from her eyes was back. So I called this woman and I was like, look, don't know what you did, don't know what you had in that water you had us drink, but we need more, and I'll pay double, and we'll come at 6 in the morning. I don't care how full your schedule is, but this is changing our life just one day at a time. And for any parent who has ever gone through that, the hope that fills you is pretty profound. And so after 3 months, my daughter was getting zoned every other week. We had a handle on her anxiety and depression. That had not happened for 3 years. So I set an intention that day that I would learn everything it took to do this for my daughter, to help her continue to heal, and to show up for any other person of a loved one who has gone through what we did. I set a big intention then without realizing it. It took a lot of sacrifice for me to go through school. Financially, I had been a stay-at-home mom for a long time, and so people got to step up to the plate and come into our lives and help so that I could make this possible. I had an incredible student experience. Our home was filled with people that were going through the same thing. And I started to learn about emotions. And I started to learn not one thing about emotion, but 1,000 things about emotion. As I sat with individuals and their feet, and not one thing was the same. Thoughts create emotions, and emotions land in our body. That's becoming really trendy and popular right now. That's pretty widely accepted. But at that time, I needed more tools because so many people were coming to me. And so I really set on this mission to learn. So I've been blessed with some incredible mentors. So the information that I am giving to you is a collection of the people that I love most, and the things, these gifts, these truth bombs that they've given to me about emotion and how it works in the body. Let me see here. So tonight I want to give you one tool first. It's a tool about truth, and there's three kinds of truth in this world. If I said to you, all dogs bite, that might not be the truth for everybody in this room. It was my husband's truth for a long time. He set out on a run one night. As he came around the corner, he was met by two big dogs, and one dog reached up and almost bit his nose off. So his truth for a long time was all dogs bite, and my truth was all dogs bite my husband. And when we go out, he's really uncomfortable if he sees a dog, right? But that wasn't the truth. Probably 90% of you in this room haven't had a dog bite you, right? So right now I just want to give you permission to, if you have a green light, take it. If it's your truth, take it. If it's not, don't worry about it. I'm going to give you a lot of tools and a lot of different things as I talk through these things. Find your truth. What is your truth? It might not be that all dogs bite. So I give you permission to do that. The first thing I want to do with you is a visualization. This is a little bit different than a meditation. One of my dear friends and mentors, she is the queen of visualization. So if you'll be patient with me and also give yourself permission, if it's not your truth, that's okay, but I want you to at least consider it for a few minutes. The premise of this visualization stems from C.S. Lewis and his famous quote that talks about building our internal framework and our internal house. And I want to take you on a visualization of your internal house and what that looks like. So if everybody could close your eyes for this visualization, this is something that you are going to create and discover. I want everybody to take a really good cleansing breath in. I want you, as you keep on pursuing this deep breathing, I want you to consider to taking this breath all the way down to your belly button. I want you to leave your shoulders out of this breathing. Leave your burdens out of the breathing and let them fall a moment, I want you to become aware of your breath as it falls in and as it falls out. I want you to visualize the house that holds your mind and your spirit. You're visualizing this space that houses your emotions, your thoughts, your experience. Visualize those spaces. Take in the beauty of what experience has created for you. Look at all the hard work you've done. All of the beauty that exists because of the discomfort you've experienced. The process you've gone through to create a magnificent space. Can you see the colors within the spaces of your mind and spirit? Can you hear sound? Is there vibration within this space? I want you to look around and take an accounting of this entire space. And once you have, I want you to go to the room in your house where your words and thoughts are. Specifically, the words and the thoughts that you have about you. What are the words that you're using with yourself? Endless chatter and thoughts that go on about you. And now look at the plethora of emotions that are created with these thoughts all about you. Is it still? Is it noisy? Is it messy? And in this moment, I want you to take an accounting of the weapons in this space. What weapons are you using with yourself? What scare tactics do you use to motivate yourself? What thoughts are you using to create guilt? Are there patterns of anger in your weapon arsenal? Is there blame? How have you used the weapon of shame with yourself? I want everyone to open their eyes. How was that? It's heavy for some of you. There's a lot of emotion tied to that as you went into that deep accounting. And now we're in the space that we need to so that I can teach you guys some tools. My goal is to help awaken you to the emotions that are going on within you. What are you using to keep you in the space where you feel stuck? You're unable to move forward. If anything came to your mind from that space, I'd encourage you to write it down. That was probably a really still awareness that you don't allow yourself to go very often. Maybe your space was beautiful, and you've done really hard work, and your weapon arsenal was empty. I congratulate you if it was, and I encourage you to keep on the path going where you've kept your space free of weapons. I want to show you tonight the gift of being generous with yourself. I want to show you how to feel really challenging and really uncomfortable emotions, and in the same space, love and accept every part of you. If no one in this room ever stepped on another treadmill again, I want you to acknowledge in this moment that you are complete and you are whole. If nobody in this room, heaven help, ever ate another fruit or vegetable again, and that would be a lot of heaven's help if that never happened. In this moment, I want you to acknowledge that you are still complete and whole. Even though you may have a room full of really impressive weaponry in your arsenal, you're complete and whole. Even though. I want you to keep that phrase in mind. Even though you experience some really uncomfortable emotions, you are complete and whole. So let that settle just for a minute. Because maybe that's familiar to you, maybe that's not. I want you to consider what thoughts are filling you the second you wake up in the morning. The second the way, there's emotions that are uncomfortable to feel, and there's life. So I want you, or I want to go through some of the emotions and functions that are in the body to help excite you and empower you within you so that you can create this love for yourself. So emotions, did you know that emotions are meant to be felt in a 50-50 spectrum? If we find ourselves all in a happy spectrum, we don't feel negative emotion, right? Do you know those people? Or maybe you're one. Okay, you're always happy. There's no negative emotion, right? Or maybe you're in this other space where it's all negative. The tones that you're feeling emotionally, they vibrate so low, there are only glimpses of being in this other part. If we had a perfect emotional wholeness, we can only know joy by knowing absolute discomfort. We can only know peace by knowing absolute chaos. The point of emotion is to be able to feel them and let them go. What is going on when we are grasping at straws just to feel a glimmer of a high vibrating emotion in our day? More than likely, you're in what we call an emotional buffer zone. We only feel all good emotions or all uncomfortable emotions, and we've lost the balance. We've gone to a buffering zone. Buffering emotions usually looks like not feeling any emotion at all, or running from them altogether. It's where we get into addiction, with substance, food, or addiction to a high in the body of some sort to feel anything but the discomfort of the emotion going on. So some of the time we spend a lot of time and energy, or most of the time we spend a lot of time and energy resisting the emotions we're feeling. And the bad news about that strategy is that what we resist persists. And so we have to try harder to resist that emotion. We go into further buffering modes. So the energy that we use should be used to feel a wide variety of emotions. And now when we buffer, it actually looks like a marathon just trying to escape our emotions. Why do we try so hard to be in the buffer zone when it takes so much work? I truly think most people, we just don't know how to deal with emotions. So I want to give you some ideas on how to more fully create a life where you can feel emotion and it can be released. So did you know that an emotion, scientifically an emotion, takes 90 seconds to feel and release? 90 seconds. How many of you guys are on 90 days with an emotion? Same emotion, right? Me. That happens to me all the time. If we had a really wealthy knowledge of the names of the emotions, of all the emotions, and we could identify those emotions really quickly, just acknowledging and naming the specific emotion is 80% of creating a release in our body. 20% of it is choosing to let that emotion leave our body. I'm just gonna say that one more time. 80% of releasing emotion is naming it. Specifically naming the emotion. Not happy or not sad. Bothered, frustrated, angry. Going deep with the name of the emotion. 80% is naming it. It takes the vibration completely down. 20% is choosing to let it go. Why is it so hard to do that? Why is that not normal for a 90-second process to be going on in here? When we don't do that, we become our emotions. When we become our emotion, we lose that connection of our wholeness. Emotions are not meant to be our identity. That changed my life when I figured that out with my daughter. She was not her anxiety. She was not her depression. She was so much more. When we opened that up and unlocked that gate, that's when progress started happening. A wise mentor once told me that our emotions are like shoes. How sad would it be if you and I were in the same shoes we had when we were emotions are meant to be changed out. Just think if you went to a black tie event in some nasty old sneakers, you never chose to switch your shoes out. So I want you to consider that with emotions. If you love shoes or you love switching those out, love feeling different emotions, even though they're uncomfortable. So I want to talk to you about this idea I came up with. I was telling a client who had so much anxiety, it was coming out in tremors in her body. She was young, she was in her early 50s, And I had this epiphany, and it kind of connected me to a Louise Hay's little excerpt that I saw years ago. And so I came up with this. Emotions are like raindrops. When we use an umbrella, we get awareness of what the rain is and what the rain looks like that's falling. That umbrella protects our whole and complete nature of who we are. When we use that umbrella, we have the ability to observe the raindrops falling around us. Oftentimes, we are tricked with that umbrella, and we flip it upside down, and we think our job is to collect the raindrops. That gets really uncomfortable, right? We're soaking wet. Number one, we start to drown because we can't move very well. We just fill up one umbrella and we carry another umbrella. We're drowning in the water that's all around us. But really, if we're doing emotion right, we should be using that umbrella to observe the emotions going on around us instead of being saturated with this water that's falling. Anxiety is not an emotion. I am 100% convinced anxiety is thousands of emotions. More than 2, 3, 10, 20 emotions that are begging to be addressed and released in the body. Depression is not an emotion. It's thousands of very low vibrating emotions that want to be addressed. Depression is just what keeps us stuck in that, in the inability to get out of that. So I want to tell you guys this cool little tool that I use. It's called rumination, and I want to illustrate it with a Bob Proctor story. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Bob Proctor at all. He has a really awesome book. He's a business coach. He does lots of cool things for business owners, but he talks a lot about energy. And the book, You Were Born Rich, he shares a really cool story. So I learned about this idea called rumination. Rumination is the brain's ability, when you feel an emotion, it's like it gives it a number. Okay, so when we feel angst, or when we use the word fussy at our house a lot, because I have teenagers and babies, and fussy just describes them both really well. So let's say fussy pulled up the number 412, and your brain is like a Rolodex, okay? And so when you start to feel that emotion, your mind is going to ruminate, and it's going to pull up every time you felt 412 from the time you were born. That's why when we feel emotions, man, we go all out, and it just compounds and compounds. So all the times you haven't released that fussy emotion, rumination shows up, and it just shows up really big. When you feel that rage, and it's connected to all the other times that you've bought into that pattern of rage and you haven't released it, it's going to show up every single time. And so the brain's going to look for all of the 412s, or all of that number of emotion that's shown up, and it's going to keep on doing it over and over again. Well, Bob Proctor tells a really cool story. It's called the 333 story. Bob Proctor is a very wealthy businessman. He has made quite a bit of money and now goes around coaching people on how to make money for themselves. And while he was on hiatus from business coaching one time, in his hometown they experienced, I think it was a big flood or something, and he decided to go back to his hometown and help the community raise money to help remedy all of the damage that was done. And so he decided that in 3 days from the time that disaster happened, in a 3-hour time frame, they were going to raise $3 million. Has anyone heard this story before? No? Okay. They were going to raise this money. And so he called a meeting with everybody that he knew in this town, all the radio stations, all the news stations, all the people of influence that he could get the word out to. He brought these people into a meeting and he said, how are we going to make this happen? How are we going to make this $3 million mark in a 3-hour time period? Every single person that challenged him or told him it couldn't happen, he dismissed. And he let them go out of the room. And guess what Bob Proctor did? In 3 hours, he raised $3 million. He met his goal. And the way he did that was by saying next, 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 and dismissing all the people who told him he couldn't. So I want to tie that into rumination. Every time your body starts to pull your 412 or your 533 of that emotion and it goes up, get an awareness of what's going on. Why are you yelling at your kids? Why are you at this for the 17th time this week? Why, right? Why are you trying to cover up or swallow this emotion? I want you to tell your body next, next, next. Your body knows to start pulling a different tone in its emotional Rolodex. You just need to have awareness. advice, but my best work is done individually and with specific questions to give you ideas to how to think about it differently. So if anyone in here is willing to be vulnerable, in just a few minutes we're going to go to questions so that I can help you guys with what you're dealing with specifically. But this is how emotion works in the body. There's a school of thought that certain emotions are held within certain organs or certain areas of the body. I want to go through it with you just with really good simplicity. So I want to connect you to emotions in the digestive tract, because I feel like that's probably a good thing for everybody that's here in this room. We break down food in the mouth. So breaking down new ideas or breaking apart new ideas, there's going to be some emotion showing up. How many times have you guys had canker sores in your mouth when there's something that's festering or burning? And every time you go to eat, it rips it right open. You might want to consider what festering or burning or cantankerous emotions are going on in your body when that happens. Things that are hard to swallow. How many times in life do we go through this process and there's some emotion that's really hard to swallow? If you start choking a lot or you start to notice that it hurts to swallow, consider what emotion or what situations are going on around you that are making things hard to swallow. The stomach breaks down new ideas. It breaks them down into a form that's easily accessed for the next part of the digestive system. So think about how many times, when do you have churning emotions or the inability to break things down? Look at your environment when that's going on and see what emotions are going on around you that could be trapped or hanging out in your stomach. Filtering. How many times do moms and dads or people in general who have to filter a lot of information? That's when the liver gets in trouble. The liver's amazing, and it has this incredible ability. The liver's breaking down blood and returning blood. It's cleaning lymphatic fluid and returning lymphatic fluid to the rest of the body. It's also working on creating bile to send to the gallbladder. It filters through so much of the digestive process. And so oftentimes, the liver's off when we're having a hard time sorting and filtering everything that we need to. How many times do we feel like you're not absorbing what's going on? Christmas happened, and it feels like it just came and passed without realizing what was going on. Usually there's a problem in your small intestines. Our small intestines are where we break down micronutrition. It's where we break down minerals and small details. So when the small details of life are really hard, it's usually our small intestines where we hold that emotion, and the body isn't absorbing much micronutrition at that point. The colon, letting go. How many times change in life, do we have a really hard time letting things go, and hemorrhoids or constipation show up? I promise you, it happens a lot more than you think, or when things are a pain in the butt. Literally. This emotion in the body isn't hard. It's actually really easy. I have a good friend and client. Her hemorrhoids have names, and they're the names of all four of her boys. When they are acting up or when their behaviors get crazy, with 100% accuracy, her body shows where the emotion's being held, and it is always hemorrhoids. So there is real truth to what's going on in your body with what's going on with the emotional part and the emotional component. And so don't dismiss that. It's actually so much more simple. We made it really complicated. The other thing I want to talk about is if you're feeling specific problems in your body, and you want to choose to incorporate diets, I want you to first consider that we have primary foods and secondary foods. This was taught to me by a health coach 3 years ago, and this was a game changer for me. The physical food we eat is actually our secondary food system. Our primary food system is, number one, our relationships, number two, our spirituality, number three, our physical movement, and number four, our life's work. Did you know that the body absorbs nutrients from our primary foods? Our macro counts, so our fats, carbs, and proteins, they are part of the secondary food process. And then our micronutrition is also part of that secondary food process. The micronutrition includes vitamins, elements, and minerals. And every 7 years, we turn over enough cells to make a new us. Raw ingredients make us new, so if you're struggling start to incorporate living things in the body, emotion actually passes a lot easier through us. We have a fluid environment within our lymphatic system where we're primarily sweating and crying. That's what the lymphatic system does. That's how it releases. Okay, a couple quick tools for you to use. I want you to consider when you're making food choices and how that ties to emotion. Are you going to your fridge? Are you going to your pantry? Have you ever considered the difference? I want you to consider the difference between those two places. When we go to the pantry, typically we're going to find things that are dead. Typically, there's a door to the pantry. You might be hiding in the pantry and just looking for a few seconds to collect yourself. That happens at my house. Maybe it doesn't happen at your house. The other things that you can find in the pantry, usually they're a little bit more indulgent and a little bit higher quantity in the pantry. Doesn't take a lot of thought work usually in the pantry. It's quick grab and go stuff. When you go to the fridge, there's usually foods that are alive in the fridge or that need some special care. The food that's in there, that requires an investment to put it together. So if you're in the pantry, why are you not investing in yourself to go to a little bit more work to put your food together, to be a little bit more present with that? There's also foods that need to be replaced often in the fridge, and so it attests to that cells that need to be replaced and the way the body works. Dolly Parton is one of my favorite people. I learned about her as a young girl on Oprah one day. I heard this story and I've loved her ever since. For my 40th birthday this year, my girlfriends gave me a makeup pouch that said, "What would Dolly do?" And that is one of my most favorite gifts I've ever met. Dolly Parton, when she was a young girl, she was actually raised in some pretty poor circumstances. Her book is just hysterically one of my favorites. She's actually really well educated. But as a young girl living in a very poor town, I believe it was in the Ozarks, the first impression she had of somebody that was really beautiful to her was at a really young age. And later she found out it was the town hooker. She didn't know that, but she took that into every part of her being. She talked about looking at her lipstick and looking at how feminine she was and all this incredible makeup that she had on. And she had big flouncy dresses and high shoes. And Dolly Parton, from that point on, decided that everything she did, she would do on purpose. If you want the treat, do it on purpose. Set an intention with that treat. Instead of trying to cover up those emotions that you're working through, do it on purpose. Figure out why it is you want that treat. I was working with a client today, and she's like, "I know, my life is out of control. All I can eat are Swedish fish and fizz. It's all I can do." And I'm like, "Okay, well, let's talk about that for a minute." And she's like, "Oh, well, Swedish fish is like this thing, because when I was little, my grandma, like, we'd sit together, and she'd let me pick out the red Swedish fish, and she liked the rainbow Swedish fish, and, oh, I'm just having all these problems with my daughter." And instantly I'm like, so maybe that Swedish fish represents some comfort that your grandma has passed on. Maybe she wants to give you, or maybe she's present with you in that moment. Because as you're trying to connect with your daughter, you're feeling this strain here. Why are you eating those Swedish fish? Be gentle with yourself when you try to figure it out. Be curious with yourself. Don't use those weapons. Don't go to that artillery of blame, shame, and guilt. Figure it out. Once we figured out why she was eating the Swedish fish, she actually felt happy and she was going to do it on purpose. It helped her remember her grandma. It helped her remember those really settling, nurturing feelings that she had as her grandma invested with her and sat with her. So she chose to do her Swedish fish on purpose from today on. She's like, "Ah, you're right. When that comes to me, that's what I'm going to do." The other funny thing that I had come up with a client is, she's like, "Ugh, things are out of control. My eating is out of control. I am at Mrs. Kavanaugh's twice a week." And I was like, "I love Mrs. Kavanaugh's. Marie and I are good friends. I actually helped her work at that store for years. I love the Kavanaugh's." And I'm like, "What does that store represent to you? Like, let's talk through, why do you want to go there?" And she's like, "Well, it's really pretty, and the fire's usually going. And those ladies there, they're so cute. They're like my grandma's. And they know exactly what I want." And as she starts to describe this process, and I'm like, "So what then I want you to think about, this is the last thing before we go to questions. I want you to think about your practices. What practices do you do that you might talk yourself into feeling guilty about? If you're doing a fizz run, let's talk through that. Let's talk through why you're going for the soda, okay? As you go through that fizz drive-through, I want to congratulate you. You're doing a practice of self-care. You're realizing that you need something and you're showing up to do it for yourself. Self-care is crucial, okay? So when you have that awareness, is self-care at fizz what you want to do? Well, let's talk it through another step. What do we get at fizz? Usually something that's nice and cold that we can swallow. So do we have some hot, festering emotions that we're trying to swallow or cover up? Might be something to consider, because those kind of practices or rituals are actually the body's way of solving a problem. And so I want you to look at those kinds of things as you look at practices. Now, if we're looking at a practice where you're swallowing some hot and burning emotion, maybe it's attached to a relationship that you have going on, is there a way that you could better solve that if you don't feel so great after you go to fizz? Or are you going to do your fizz on purpose and choose it with intention instead of being the victim to how you feel after and the guilt, shame, and blame that you feel after you go there? The other thought that I want to leave you guys with before we go to question and answer is, it is against human nature to completely stop something cold turkey. It's against human nature. We best are served when we stop things one bite at a time and one ounce at a time. When we realize and recognize that we want to change something for a different result, when we take it away 1 ounce or one bite or one chocolate squirt at a time, we're actually left with the emotion that we were covering up every time we swallowed or chewed something. And so I want you to be gentle with yourself. If you decide that you are going to cut down sugar, don't blow up the whole mountain. Just try to do it one bit at a time and address the emotion that comes up as you're left without that last ounce or that last bite. And then figure out, maybe there's a practice that you can do instead, like meditation or something that you're going to do for yourself that still solves all those problems or all those needs that you're having, but it does it with a different result. Only quit the fizz if you feel like it's a major problem for you, if you feel like you're not doing it and you're not having intention with it. Just look at those practices that you have, that you've got going that you're not doing with intention. Okay, this is my favorite part, the question part. Anybody willing to be vulnerable or willing to kind of put themselves out there for a minute and ask any questions or anything that I can help you walk through? Any food ideas? I'm really geeky over food, over supplements, that kind of stuff that actually really lights me up when I get to talk supplements and food. Yes?
Yeah. So, I'm going to be
you about anything, you go and you go and you go. And at the end of those three pages, I want you to write one paragraph about the gratitude and love that you feel that you were able to experience that emotion. And then I want you to take a write or two. And that won't be a one and done sitting. That'll probably actually be a lot of good work. But now you have awareness about it, right? Now you have awareness, and there's probably a lot of healing that's going to go on, that's going to attach to some other things. But your lungs are going to start to clear. Okay, let me geek out about food with you for a minute. Pineapple for the lungs. Okay, we call it coronavirus at our house because I have a really idiotic 16-year-old son that likes to make fun of everything, right? But you're sure he had coronavirus 2 weeks ago. So coronavirus is coming, so this is just like a little truth bomb that can add to that. Pineapple has insane amounts of bromelain in it. Bromelain is an anti-inflammatory, and it expunges mucus. Those are terrible words. It expunges mucus from the lungs beautifully. And so I want you to give yourself permission to go get a pineapple every couple of days or when it flares. And by supporting the body physically, we can actually clear out a ton of emotion that way. So, is that good? So now you know what you're in for. Raise your hand. Speak with caution, right? It's just good and normal for me. Anybody else?
Yes. So when you talk about like depression and anxiety being like a whole ton of emotions overlapped, and when you talk about like saying next and being able to give your body, giving yourself permission to move on from those emotions because it's identifying it and then choosing to leave it. So when you have something that's more complex, like depression, anxiety with tons of emotions, how do you go about unraveling that and releasing that?
One at a time. 1 ounce at a time, one bite at a time. And so when we're in that cycle of depression, one thing that's really good is to change your environment really quickly, change your environment. Our body and our spirits are actually really tied to Earth's elements. And so getting out and getting your feet in the grass, grounding, I know that that's something that you and I talk about a lot, but grounding is really powerful when we feel that depression coming on and we cannot get out of it. Changing your environment, changing something different to help that spirit start to wake up and release those different things, really powerful. Also a lot of living liquid in the body is really powerful. We're literally washing those emotions away.
What is that? Say living liquid, and I'm like,
I know. Sorry, I've been drinking the Kool-Aid so long. Thank you for stopping me. So I'm going to go to foods with fluid in them. I'm going to start to utilize oranges. I'm going to utilize cucumbers. I'm going to flush my body out with fluid other than water. Okay. Something else other than water. We have this amazing system in the body called the lymphatic system, and it primarily holds a lot of our emotions, okay? So if we can geek out for a minute over the anatomical aspect of it, we have a circulatory system that pumps blood throughout the veins in the body. The blood actually goes through a process where it's being cleaned by the circulatory system. What it cannot clean, it actually hands over and passes off to the lymphatic system. It mirrors beautifully, just like the circulatory system. It's full of like almost little vein-like things, but it's the fluid that the blood can't clean. So when we get into lymphatic fluid, it goes through this process where it cleans and it converts over to lymph, right? Back to the blood after it's gone through this process. The way we release through the lymphatic system is sweat and tears. Sweat and tears. And if we think about that process that I just described medically, it's like the top emotions that the blood can't clean. So they're intense. So when we cry and when we sweat, we're really releasing some really concentrated emotion. One other plug here, just to be a weirdo for a minute. When we're going for antiperspirant deodorant, stop buying those, guys. They are not good. They stop you from sweating. That's a terrible idea. Like, it's a terrible idea. So let's knock off the antiperspirants. Let your body sweat it out, stinky or not. Like, let's figure out what's going on there. And really, come on. Do you always want to cry? Like, let's figure out two different ways to let this stuff go. So good, squirrel.
What about night sweats then?
Oh, so good. Think about this. When you're sleeping at night, your body's in rest and repair, right? You've really zoned out from environment and what's going on in the day. So when you wake up with night sweats, your body's sweat with you, but I do. Like, it's so good. The body sends us so many good messages. If your sweat's really potent and you're wondering what the heck is going on, gosh, your lymphatic system needs some help. It needs some support. You need an internal deodorant like chlorophyll. You're low on magnesium, and so toxicity is stuck in your cells, and it needs a way to get out. And so, anyway. Sweat questions answered, right? We covered the whole vast array about sweat and everything else. Thank you. Squirrel moment. I'm sorry. Freshman to antiperspirant. All good.
So, and then how can, like, you said, put something in being aware of your emotions? Because I know I'm an emotional eater. When I'm sad, happy, bored, mm-hmm. any emotion I have, I like to eat.
Mm-hmm. So you like to comfort yourself?
Yeah.
Yeah. So is there another way that you can comfort yourself, or can you comfort yourself on purpose instead of being a victim to that comfort? Yeah. So I would say become really aware, even drinking a glass of water before you go to eat that, just to pop yourself out of that pattern. Drink a glass of water first so that you're really filling a need for yourself. You're aware, yeah, I realize you've got some needs. And then sit with it for a minute. Go to writing. If you really want to tackle emotional eating, go to writing when you go for that food. Keep a notebook in the pantry. Keep a notebook by your bed when those night sweats start. Your body wants to tell you what's going on. I promise, I promise, I promise. It wants to tell you. And you start writing down anything that comes to mind. Those are your core issues. And after you've kind of worked through those and written those down, you're going to be able to breathe just a little bit easier because you've released those emotions that are tying you to that comfort eating.
Yes.
I know it's work, right? And it's switching a pattern that we're in, and it's being aware of those things. Awareness is half the battle, and acknowledging it.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Nobody cares at this point, right? Okay, I just kind of want to finish up the night with just a plug to give you permission to know that you are not your emotions. If you struggle with anxiety, you are not your anxiety. You're just so much more than that. If there was a gift I could give to everybody tonight, I know it sounds cliche, but you are whole just as you are. Like, if we never did any of these other things, anything never changed. You are whole and complete just as you are. If you want to get excited about food, part of the challenge, one of the things that you win is the Medical Medium Food, the amazing food book. I can't remember the exact name of it, or Life-Changing Foods. If you want to connect to food and get excited about them, read that book. It is, you've never been so excited. Ryan was excited about a potato, like a potato, Ryan Quilter. He was excited about it after he read that book. That just sent me to the moon and back. Like, that doesn't happen very often.
What's it called again?
It's Life-Changing Foods by Anthony William. He connects you to some foods in a pretty powerful way. And that's my happy spot, is when we can use food as our physician. That's a great one. Well, thank you for letting me be with you guys tonight. This is a privilege. Good luck on your journey this month. Good luck on tackling emotion. Good luck with releasing emotion. You guys have got this, and I can't wait to hear about all the amazing things that are going to happen to you guys this month. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Heidi. I think all of you can now see why we brought her here and why I told you to take your walls down from the get-go, because she is incredibly powerful and knowledgeable, and I just second and resonate everything that she said. Especially, you just want to touch again on the writing thing. It was something I was very resistant to for a super long time, but there's something, I mean, it's weird to write things, write unfiltered, and then go outside and burn it. Like, it's really weird, but it works and it's powerful. My wife now does it. Even our little girl who was struggling with emotion, she doesn't know how to write yet, so we give her crayons, and it's like just, and she will just color out all the emotion, and then we'll burn it, and she is lighter, and she is happier. So I just wanted to, like I said, I was resistant to that for a long time, but it's incredibly powerful. So anyways, thanks again, everybody, for coming. We have some refreshments there at the back. If you bought recipe book, we have that. If you didn't buy the hard copy, an email is going to be coming to them tonight with the digital version of that. If you're interested in the challenge and exactly what it's all going to entail, whether you signed up for it or not, we have a paperback that on the table going over it. You can still sign up for it because it doesn't start till Monday, but either way, we just want you to become your best selves, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. So thanks again for coming. Appreciate you guys.
Thank you.